So do you see a lot of people putting these practices to work?
Yes, and it can be very exciting. Let me show you an example where we went into a real-world lab where they had way too much column and they weren't optimized at all. Now here we've got a cumene analysis. They're doing purity of cumene. That's the large peak in the middle, which is isopropylbenzene, for those of you who don't work with this compound. They have a 60-meter, 0.32 millimeter ID column. They're doing 20 impurities in cumene, and right away you can see there's a lot of runtime at the end that seems to be a waste of time. Overall, it's a 30-minute run where we're waiting 10 minutes for the last two peaks, basically. There's a lot of things we can do here, but right away I knew we didn't need a 60-meter column. So I asked the person I was working with, is there any rule that says we have to use a 60-meter column? And they said, no, we can change it. So we got a column half the length, and we ran the runtime to under 16 minutes.
Did you use Method Translator to do this?
Actually, we didn't use the Method Translator to do that part. We went to a 30-meter 0.25 after that, and again, we had to mess around with the temperature programs, and this was outside the translator. But from that point on, we did use the Method Translator, and that's where it really helped us. We're down to a 7-minute runtime at this point, but why stop there? Now, I know that going from a 30-meter 0.25 to a 20-meter 0.18 will give us the same resolution in 10 less meters. That's the whole faster analysis thing, decreasing the length and decreasing the diameter to get back the resolution. So right away, we go from 7 minutes to 4.4 minutes with the same relative resolution, and the translator did the job for us. I saved that screen just to show you how it worked. So here it is right here. Now they're doing what they used to do in 30 minutes in just over 4 minutes. So in a routine analysis, they can do 6 times as many samples as they used to do in the same time frame.
So did you try hydrogen to make it even faster?
I know it seems silly when you're already at 4.4 minute runtime, but of course I did. And now we're under 4 minutes. So we go in here, we click translate only, we click on hydrogen, we put in our methods, and now we're at under 4 minutes. What used to be a 30-minute runtime.
Wow, that's super fast. Are there any other ways to use the Method Translation software tool?
There are a couple of neat tricks I've learned using Method Translation software, and I've saved one here. Let's take a look. So let's say I'm using a 30-meter, 0.25 millimeter ID column. I've got helium as carrier gas, and my starting temperature is 80 degrees. Now, it does really matter what temperature you start there because that's directly going to impact the pressure needed to drive the flow. Now we're going to run at 1.0 mils per minute, and that's a typical flow rate for a column of this size. It tells me that I have 13.696 will be my head pressure. Now, I can simulate what it would look like if I use this particular analysis with a mass spec. So we put zero in the outlet pressure, and now I've got what it looks like at a mass spec. The head pressure goes to 9.5 psi. Quite a bit of difference. Let's say I'm a guy in a mass spec lab, I've worked out my method, I've taken my helium carrier gas and my 1 milliminute flow rate, and I've worked up this complicated temperature program, and I send it over to the FID guy, and he messes it up. His chromatogram looks completely different. Why? Because I forgot to tell him I have a vacuum, and if I put that in there, now, I've got a different head pressure, I've got a different temperature program than he does. If we look at his method over here, translate only, he's got the same column, helium carrier gas, same flow rate, but his outlet pressure is higher, therefore his temperature program is different. Why? Because we have a gas that's compressible. At the other end of my column, there's a vacuum, so the velocity is just flying. In fact, what it says here is that the output velocity is very large. It doesn't even give you a number. So the speed, the average velocity of the carrier gas as it goes down the length of the column, is faster in the mass spec than it is in the FID. And therefore, I have to compensate with a thermal program, and I have a temperature program that's moving through the column so that things don't get messed up. Another thing Method Translation software can help is with assessing method feasibility. Let's say you want to do one of these flow ramps at the end of the run. You've got one of those lonely late eluders that are way out there, and you don't really want to go hotter, so you try cranking up the flow rate. Well, how do I know if I'm going to have enough pressure at that time? Because as we know, gases become more viscous with temperature, so it takes more pressure to drive the flow at the end of the run where it's really hot. All right, well, let me switch this back to 14.696. And I'm going to an FID. I want to give you the worst case scenario. I have a 1 mm flow rate, a 30 meter 0.25 column. At the end of run, let's say I'm at 350 degrees. I'm about as hot as you want to take a DB1. And I'm just going to click on isothermal here so we don't get confused on this stuff. So 350 degrees at 1 mm cause 27 PSI to drive that flow. Now let's say I want to do a flow program. How high of a flow can you go to? Well, let me try 16 mils a minute under these same conditions. Now the translator says I almost need 143 PSI. And most of the standard instruments we have 100 PSI inlet. You're not supposed to go higher than that. We do have a specialized EPC that goes up to 150, but if I have 100 PSI inlet, I'm too high of a pressure. So I see that the maximum flow rate, let's try that. Let's put in 100 PSI and find out that our maximum flow rate that we're going to be able to use at 350 degrees is going to be 8.4 mils a minute, and that'll be the maximum. So let's put in something a little bit lower than that, 7.5 mils per minute. And now we can see that it takes about 93 PSI. And that's one of the beautiful ways that Method Translator can really help you figure out the feasibility for pressure programming, flow programming, whether or not you're going to have enough pressure to do those kinds of things. Now, the only thing left to check is to make sure that I got enough pressure at the tank coming to the instrument so I can get to that 93 PSI.
You mentioned earlier that the translator could help with figuring out phase ratio. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Sure. Let's say I'm going to buy a new column. I have a 30 meter 0.25 and for fun, let's make it a 0.5 micron film. And I want to go to one of those new high efficiency columns, the 20 meter 0.18. So I put in 20 meters, I put in 180 micron or 0.18 millimeter ID. And now I don't want the same film thickness. I want the same phase ratio. If I click that over here to get the 125 phase ratio, now it tells me my new film thickness that I need in this column is a 0.36 film, so I know which column to buy to get the same results.
Are there any other critical dimensions the method translation software can help me with?
Let's talk about average linear velocity. Now, over time, you're likely to be trimming the column with routine maintenance as it gets dirty or starts falling apart, whatever. At a certain amount of length, it's time to let the instrument know so it won't keep putting the same pressure on the column. If you have the same pressure and you have a shorter length column, you're going through the column faster, but you're still using the same temperature program. You're going to be running through the column faster, and the column temperature won't be as hot as it used to be, and the temperature that all the peaks see will be slightly different. That can move things around. Well, you can use the method translator to see how that impacts the various lengths as the column gets shorter over time. So instead of putting 30 meters in there, let's try putting 29.5. We've cut off half a meter. Now, let's get our flow rate down to where it's a normal flow rate again, 1 mm. We've got 27 PSI to drive 1 mm at 29.5 meters, where in 30 meters, it's pretty close. So it didn't make a big change. If we make a big change here, let's make this 27 meters. Now instead of 27 PSI, it's 25 PSI.
Okay.
So let's summarize. The main thing we need to make sure of is that whatever our original method is, whatever column stationary phase you're using, we have to stay in that same stationary phase. The method translation software will not work if you're going from a DB1 to, say, a DB-wax. And I'm going to be so specific to say that if you're using a DB1, you need to transfer the method to a DB1, not even an HP1, a similar phase. It's possible that you might see slight selectivity difference between those two columns. Stationary phase plays a major role, and if you're going to change stationary phase, that's more of a method development process than the software can handle. But once we have the same stationary phase, we have the ability to change diameter and length to improve our analysis times. When we change diameter, we need to make small incremental changes for the best results. And as far as carrier gas goes, well, we've learned hydrogen is our best friend at high velocities. Helium works fine. And nitrogen, we don't see too much anymore, except for very simple analysis or because it's very inexpensive. Now, for length, we can go to shorter length columns, and as we saw in the Q-mean analysis, sometimes we can cut our columns right in half and not lose anything because we were in overkill mode. Lastly, temperature programming. This is the most difficult thing to do when translating methods. That's where method translation software is so helpful. It takes even your most difficult ramps and does a great job scaling to the new temperatures. And it will also tell you, by looking at the different parameters, if it's even possible to try that.